Good morning, church. Great to see you all. We stand together. How many of you are ready to worship the Lord this morning? Amen. And can we sing this together?
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
lift that up again.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
living and true, awesome God, the God who is able, God who is willing, God who is here with us in this room right now, who can do things far above all that we ask. You can do greater things in our midst, Lord, than we can think of. And Lord, you want to reveal yourself to us right here, right now, God. You want to remind us you're the God who is able. And you're the God who is for us. You're the God who will never, never leave us nor forsake. We praise you, and we thank you for that. It's because of that we dedicate and give you our time, our hearts, our lives, our service, Lord, for you to be glorified and honored in it. We love you, we praise you, and we ask this in Jesus' powerful and precious name. All of God's saints said, amen. Brothers and sisters, are you glad you serve an able God? Amen. Before you find a seat, say hey to some people, introduce yourself if you don't know them.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Do we have an excellent worship team, or do we have an excellent worship team? I know that they would never take any credit on their own because they're humble servants of the Lord, but I think it was good that we just applauded them right there because I know even myself, I come into church at some times and I feel a little bit disconnected from the Lord just because of the barrage of the distractions that we get in the world, different things that take place, and every time you start worshiping the Lord, all that just gets set aside as they take us right into the throne room and we get an opportunity to get our hearts right and settled with the Lord. And then we spend time in His Word, corporate prayer together, and certainly some more time of worship. Amen? Amen? Amen. Well, I certainly do want to welcome you to South Hill Calvary Chapel this morning, especially those of you who might be new and visiting our fellowship. We are absolutely blessed to have you here, and we want to show you that by putting our hands together. Amen. Amen. The reason why you get warm applause is we're absolutely blessed to have you amongst us. We consider it a privilege. Our prayer and hope is that when you come through the doors, you would feel like this is a place where you could worship the Lord alongside of us. That's certainly our desire, and we're hoping to do that with you in short order. Now, if you have bulletins in your hands, now is the perfect time to open those, as there are some announcements I would like to direct you to. The first of which is just a quick reminder, this evening will in fact be holding our summer supper, and that is going to be not here, but once again a reminder at Rainier Woods Park. Now, if you do not have this particular flyer saved from last Sunday service, there are these available on the information table. Like, for instance, if you can't remember how to get to Rainier Woods Park, if you don't have a smartphone with GPS guidance, you can grab this and do it old school and see the directions right on paper and bring that with you, and because we want to see you there. Also, I did welcome those of you who are new to the church. We would absolutely love and invite you to come alongside and enjoy the Sunday supper with us as well. What a perfect opportunity to meet people in the church, make some new friends, and just join in with our fellowship. We'd love to break bread with you and enjoy a special time in the Lord. So come out for that. That's at 4 o'clock p.m. once again at Rainier Woods Park. Now, secondly, next Sunday evening, and we've been talking about this for a couple weeks, is the special church service. Now, there's a little minor detail printed out just because we've got a lot of surprises for you. This is going to be where the eldership will be sharing some updates and exciting announcements of all that the Lord is doing in our church body, and we'd love to be able to share that with you. So we would highly encourage you to find out what the Lord is doing and to be there next Sunday evening at the special church service, and that, of course, will be here in the sanctuary. And then lastly, on my part, as far as the announcements are concerned, in two Saturdays, pull out your June 9th Men at Work flyer, this bulletin insert. We are going to be holding the Men at Work event. We have been doing this annually during the summers. And this is, let's just say, you know, we come to men's breakfast during the rest of the year to get fed ourselves and to spend time in fellowship. with the brethren, and this is our opportunity as men to be able to go out and bless other people and serve them and wash feet as Jesus has washed ours and laid his life down. So we would encourage you to take a look and to participate in this Men at Work. On the back of the flyer, there's a question, need some help. We need two things. We need men to serve, of course, otherwise it wouldn't be possible for us to bless anybody if there is no men to serve. And then secondly, we need jobs to do. So if you know anybody that's in need that may be a benefit that we can help out, please let us know and fill out the back of this bulletin insert. And once you're done with that, you can drop it off in one of the two tithes and offerings boxes located at the back of the sanctuary. And then we'll make sure to contact you, get the details, and get the job sites lined up that we can attend to. Amen? Amen. All right. I think lastly, I have cell phones. If you do have any electronic devices that might go off and disrupt as we're going through the study of God's word, now while I'm finishing up, it's the perfect time to silence those or turn them off. Also, if you need to leave, we absolutely understand that there are things that will call you outside of the sanctuary while we're teaching the word. We'd love to have you back in, of course, to finish up. It always helps to minimize distractions of when you re-enter the sanctuary that it looks like there are a couple seats open in the last few rows. If you have any questions or concerns or would like to be directed to overflow, the ushers are always there in the back of the sanctuary to assist you as necessary. And now I'm going to turn it over. We do have a special announcement to make, so Pastor Ron's going to come up and lead us from here on out. Thank you.
Morning. How's everybody doing? Doing well? Good, 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 good. We have a baby dedication. So come on up. Uh-oh, is she melting down a little? Ooh, not good. Make it fast. All right, God bless his child. All right, let's open our Bibles too. I'll let mom hold. This is little Savannah Brin Chapel. And this is Pastor Allen. He's our children's ministry pastor and his lovely wife, Melissa. They have other two other children, little Noah and don't tell me now, Noah and help me out here, Caroline. There's so many. It just, that's what happens when you. So little Noah and Violet. No, Caroline. I'm totally kidding. And we want to bless them, and we want to be able to dedicate the little child, Savannah to the Lord, and we do that so that we, as a church body, might come alongside of them in raising little Savannah Brin up to the Lord, raising her up in the ways of the Lord. We accept that that is our responsibility as her church body, amen? And not just theirs. We stand with them in that process. And part of what we like the parents to do is to pick up a verse that means something special for the child, and Pastor Allen's going to share that right now while we pray that she'll calm down for just
here, let me see. So the verse that I pick out is on So the verse that I picked out is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verses 23 and 24, and it reads, "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it." We pick that verse out because that's obviously what we want for all of our children and for Savannah as well. We pray that the God of peace himself would sanctify her completely, and she would just be kept at the day of coming of our Lord. And we know that the Lord is faithful and he will do it as we are responsible as a church to do our job.
Amen. Let's join Alan and Melissa in prayer as we pray for little Savannah Brin. Father God, we thank you so very much for this precious, precious little girl. We thank you, Lord God, for your faithfulness in answering prayers for her throughout Melissa's pregnancy, for a healthy pregnancy and a safe delivery, Lord God, and we just thank you for answered prayer. Lord, we want to lift up little Savannah to you, but we pray, Lord God, that that Alan and Melissa, we stand with them in agreement that they would raise her up in the ways of the Lord. We pray for Noah and Caroline that they would just be a part as a family of raising her up in the Lord by their example, O Lord. And we stand with them as a church, Lord God. We acknowledge, Lord, that we live in a hostile world that wants to bring harm upon little ones. And so we stand with them to protect her emotionally, and physically, and spiritually. And Lord, we stand with them as a church body to lift her up to the Lord, to dedicate her to the Lord. And we pray, Lord, that they would always minister to her in the ways of the Lord, trusting you, just as those scriptures say, that you will be faithful to accomplish all those things that they pray. Thank you, Lord God, for her birth. Thank you for her life. We look forward to seeing all that you're going to do in her. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Look at that. She's like a little mini Noah, isn't she? See ya. All right. And lost my touch. There we go.
There we go. We got it.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer now. Okay. Do you want me to sit down? Or are we good? Okay, because... Oh, man. Alan cracks me up. He really does. That guy can get me laughing. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are so very grateful to you for your goodness and your kindness. We thank you, Lord, for the miracle of birth. And we thank you, Lord, for the absolute miracle of rebirth, which is even more spectacular, oh God. We want to come before you, Lord, and first of all, we want to just pray, Lord God, for those who are just grieving the loss of loved ones who have passed because of the wars of the past, Lord, and of the present as well. We're sobered, Lord, by the bravery of the men and women who have given their lives to defend the freedoms that we have to have church publicly, the freedoms that we have, Lord, in our lives. We do not take that lightly, and we praise you, and we thank you for that. We pray, Lord God, for all those in our church body, Lord, who are going through difficult times, whether it be searching for employment, Lord, we ask that your hand would be upon them, helping them to trust you that you're going to be faithful to provide. We pray for those who are suffering ill health, Lord. We pray for little Lexi Brock, Lord, as she was taken to the emergency room this morning. We ask, Lord, that your hand would be upon her. Thank you, Lord, that she's stable. We pray that you would give the doctors wisdom as they seek to treat her, Lord God, and that she would be healed in that process, Lord. Whether you do it miraculously or medicinally, Lord God, we acknowledge that you indeed are the divine physician, Lord. We pray for Wendy Knopp's mother, Lord God, who was recently diagnosed with lung cancer. Draw near to the family, Lord. We pray, Lord God, for little Bentley Vincent, Lord, Julie Arthen's nephew. We pray, Lord God, that you would just bring complete healing to that little guy. And, Lord, that there would be in no way be any brain damage whatsoever from these just this lack of oxygen to his brain, O Lord. We believe that you can do that. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, O Lord. We want to pray, Lord, for the wife of Les Sample, who was just recently passed away, Lord God. We pray for his wife as she grieves his loss, O Lord. We pray for John, his friend of Kevin's, Lord God, who he worked with, Lord, his sudden death, Lord, at the age of 53. We pray for all the family members, Lord God, and we ask that you would just minister, Lord God, in a powerful way to that family, Lord, and use this tragedy, use this difficulty, Lord, to bring them to you, we ask. We pray for all those outreaches, ministries that are represented here in our church body, the prison ministry, the outreach ministry to the mall and in Tacoma, Lord. And we also pray for the prison ministry. We ask that your hand would be upon all those involved with that, Lord God. We pray for, want to lift up Rich to you, Lord God, and who's going to be deployed, Lord, on Tuesday We lift him up to you, Lord. We pray that your hand would be upon him. We pray that you would give him strength of heart and encouragement, O Lord, and that you would just draw near to the family in his absence, Lord God, and thank you for him. Thank you for his willingness, Lord God, to serve our nation in the armed forces, O Lord. We also pray, Lord God, for our president and his administration. We're commanded to pray. We want to be faithful to do that, Lord God. We trust that in your sovereignty, you've appointed him. We ask that you would just bring him under the conviction of the Holy Spirit to vote according to biblical conscience rather than what the people want, O Lord. We also want to pray for all of our missionaries, and we ask that you would draw near to them. We pray especially for those who are serving in harm's way, that you would watch over the Vargas family, that you would watch over, Lord God, the Meyer family as they serve faithfully, O Lord. We pray for the missions teams that are preparing to go out, O Lord. We lift up to you the Joshuas who are getting ready to go to Belize. We lift up to you Brian Hedrick, and we lift up Jay Richards to you, O Lord, and Jim Shufflin to you as they prepare to go to Haiti, Lord God. We ask that your hand would be upon them. We pray, Lord God, for just all those who were able to support in missions. We look forward to a new and new ways that we can continue to bless them and encourage them, O Lord, as you would direct us. And now, Lord, we ask that you would be with our children's ministers and that you would minister through them to our little ones, as well as our junior high team, Jason Murdoch and his team, Lord God, as they minister to our junior hires. We're so grateful, Lord God, for them. We're grateful, Lord, for the facility that you give us and the opportunity you give us, Lord God, to be here as often as we are here. And now, Lord, we pray that you would receive our tithes and our offerings, Lord God, as an extension of our worship, Lord. We acknowledge before you that absolutely everything that we have comes from you. We know that to be true. We trust that to be true. And we ask, Lord God, that you would just encourage us to hold fast to that confidence, Lord, that it all comes from you. And that, Lord, you would just receive this this humble gift of our tithes and our offerings to advance your kingdom, Lord God. We know that you don't need our money, but, Lord, we know that we're commanded to give cheerfully, and we do so now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Pray that you would give the leadership wisdom, divine wisdom and insight on how we would invest the resources in the furthering of your kingdom. We pray all these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God.
Song, I'm reminded of the times that I sing that and he's not my everything. And it's always a reminder to just search in my heart. I know that that is each of our prayers, that it is the cry of each of our hearts this morning as we stand and we sing to him. I want to just sing that again and just renew our hearts to him, asking him to be our absolute everything. Lord, be our everything. We want nothing in our lives to separate us from what you have for us. Thank you, Lord.
My everything.
Hallelujah, Lord, that is our prayer, that you would be our everything in every way, O Lord, every area of our lives, that we wouldn't hold anything back. Be our everything, Lord. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. A couple of quick announcements I want to make before we get into our study this morning. First of all, today after this service, immediately after this service, we're having our Israel 2013 tour informational meeting here in the sanctuary at 1:30. So if you have any interest at all in going to Israel, we would encourage you to come here. I'm going to show a bunch of slides and kind of give you a brief preview of all the places that we're going to be visiting. If you'll look in your bulletins, there's just a flyer in there that says Israel 2013 tour with all of the details of the trip on the back. And then also at that meeting, we'll have some color brochures, if you haven't picked them up yet, that are on the information table, that even give you more of the details, the actual dates that we leave, when the first deposit's due, and all that good stuff. And I'm going to be able to show you the slides. I'm going to be able to answer all the questions that you might have. This will be the third tour that I've led to Israel, and then it'll be the third, and it'd be the fifth time that I've been there. The more times you go, the more it makes sense. Everything begins to make sense. And I cannot just overemphasize the importance of going sometime in your lifetime as a Christian. So we want to give you plenty of time to talk a couple of the kids or whatever you need to do. No, I'm kidding, not the kids. But just seriously, just to look for creative ways to raise money to be able to go, creative legal ways, I should say, to go to Israel. So be sure to come out for that. And then finally, I want to mention there's another flyer in your bulletin, and that is for the All Church Work Party. I don't know how many people we have signed up now, but I think we had probably 6 to 10 signed up prior to last service. We don't own this facility, obviously. We lease it, and the relationship that we've had for the past 9 years with this school here has been just phenomenal. When we first rented the facility 9 years ago, the church that had it before us, they'd grown significantly large, and they were a little bit hesitant to lease it to us. And we assured them that we would treat the facility as our own, and they were still a little bit hesitant. We weren't allowed to go downstairs We could only use it on Wednesday. We didn't have a Wednesday service in, so it was only on Sunday. And little by little, we proved to them and showed to them that we would indeed treat this facility as our own, to now basically what they say is, you can use the facility whenever we're not using it for the furthering of God's kingdom. And we are able to do that at probably a fifth or sixth of what it would cost us if we were renting from anywhere else. It is a wonderful, wonderful relationship. And we want to be able to bless them. We have this work party every year. We're going to be painting the kitchen next Saturday. We're going to be doing all of the chairs. We let them use our sound system and our chairs anytime that they need them. They've obviously allowed us to paint the sanctuary and to hang banners and that sort of thing. It's just a tremendous blessing from the Lord, and we want to bless them in return. We're going to be restriping the parking lot, cleaning up the grounds, and we could use literally 30 to 40 people with no problem whatsoever. I know that that's asking a lot to take out of a busy weekend. I know weekends are precious, but it would give you an opportunity to give back to the Lord what he has so richly blessed us with. So if you can make it for any or all of that portion, that would be a tremendous help, and it would be a tremendous blessing to the school. And so if you can, please sign up. And you may be thinking, well, I think I'm going to go, but I'll just show up. I don't need to sign up. We need you to sign up, because we're going to provide a barbecue lunch for you, and we want to make sure that we have plenty of food for you. And if you don't sign up and then you show up, then you'll work really, really hard, and you'll get like a fourth of a hamburger, and you'll be really mad at us, and like three chips and stuff like that. And we don't want that to happen. So please get signed up for that and come out and so we can bless the school and at the same time bless our church body. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the book of Acts chapter 15. Acts chapter 15. If you need a Bible, please raise your hand and one of the ushers will be sure to get one to you. Raise it nice and high. We are in Acts chapter 15. I think we all come from a variety of backgrounds when it comes to churches and church experiences. And I don't know, we've got somebody over here that needs a Bible. You guys sleeping on the job back there? What's going on? No, I'm just kidding. We all come from just different backgrounds where we've had situations that have been not so good and others that have been better. And I was raised in a family that was, I guess they would have called themselves Christians intellectually, but we never went to church. We never read the Bible. So, I mean, I don't really believe I was raised in a Christian home. And so we had some family or some friends of our family that were very, very good Bible-believing Christians. And the man in particular, in my mind, when I think of a godly man to this day, I think of this particular individual. He actually got me involved in my first Bible study, my high school Bible study, as I was a new Christian. I was just a few years old in the Lord. And I remember, I believe they attended a Baptist church, and in their church they had pews, and they had this special event that they were calling Pack-a-Pew. Has anybody ever been to Pack-a-Pew before? Well, oh, all right, there we go. Was it a Baptist church? There you go. All right, that must have been that same year, same program. It was Pack-a-Pew. It was Pack-a-Pew night. And so what the idea was is you were going to pack as many people in those pews as you possibly could. You were going to go to the highways and byways, and you were going to invite people to come. And I didn't even understand what it was. I just liked saying Pack-a-Pew. I liked saying that. It had a ring to it. And my stepfather, Bill, he caught on to it. And I said, Bill, are we going to go to Pack-a-Pew tonight? And he said, are you kidding? He says, if I go to Pack-a-Pew, everybody goes to Pack-a-Pew. And he just kept saying that, and I'd laugh. I'd crack up when he'd say that. And pretty soon he'd say it again. We going to Pack-a-Pew? And I must have asked him 20 times, if I go to Pack-a-Pew, everybody goes to Pack-a-Pew. So I could not wait to go to Pack-a-Pew. And as we got there, shortly after we were there, I was sorely disappointed as a young man, because I realized that Pack-a-Pew wasn't quite what I thought it was going to be in my own mind. And I think a lot of times that's what can happen with church. We go to church, we have certain expectations of what church is going to be. Some of you may be visiting and you have this expectation of what church is going to be, and I can only say, Lord, please, please let them be filled and let them be encouraged. I think of how many of us have just had so many different concepts of what church is all about. I spent 24 years as a Christian. My first 24 years as a Christian, I was saved in 1977, just really fully committed my heart to the Lord at the age of, I think I was 24 years old at the time. And I spent the next 24 years as a Christian trying to understand this thing, this organism, this organization, this institution, whatever you want to call it, trying to understand church. 24 years. And as I thought I had a pretty good understanding what it was, the Lord led us here in June of 2001 to start a Bible study at the Melcorum YMCA, and then our first church service in October of 2001 at Ferrucci Junior High School in the cafeteria. And from that point forward, I spent another 9 years doing church, another 9 years teaching through the Bible, teaching through the New Testament, ministering in the hospitals, marrying people and counseling people and doing their memorial services and all kinds of things. And to be honest with you, it has really been for me in my 35 years of walking with the Lord, for me, it has really been in the last 18 months that I feel that I really, really understand it. Finally, I feel like finally I'm kind of understanding what it means to be the church. And really, a large part of our meeting or our church service next Sunday and our service next Saturday is really kind of sharing with you from my heart, sharing with you from the eldership's heart, what does it mean to be the church? And I must tell you that as I stand before you today, I'm crazy about the church. I realize that who would have ever thought when I was thinking of going to Pacapew, when I would have gone, that I would, man, I love the church. I love our church. I love just being at church. I love coming to church. I just love being a part of the body of Christ. In fact, I don't think there's virtually anything about church that I do not love. And why is it that I say that? Because the church is the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as his bride, the day is quickly approaching when he is coming to take us home. Amen? When he is coming to take his church, to take his bride, to be with him forever and ever. But having said that, I do need to say that what I don't like about the church today, in fact, what I would say as strongly as what I hate about the church today, and what I would go so far as to say what I believe the Lord hates about the church today, is what the church has become, rather than what his son Jesus died for the church to be. And unfortunately, I think there's a big difference. And the reason that I say that is because chapter 15 here in the book of Acts, it is perhaps the most important chapter in the book of Acts, because in it, we see the single greatest potential threat to the destruction of the church and what remains to be one of the greatest threats of the church today. And that threat is this. Listen, it is the threat that there are other ways to get to heaven, that there are other ways to be reunited to a holy and to a perfect God, which in effect leads to other ways of doing, other ways of being the church. And I have to be careful here because I can get really worked up about this issue, because having spent the first 14 of my 35 years as a Christian wandering around from different winds of doctrine, I get really irritated when I see some of the things that are taking place under the guise of being the church, and I see that it doesn't line up scripturally. And part of the reason that I'm so passionate about it is because in that wandering, I want us to have an understanding as his bride, as his church, of what church is supposed to be like. And what really gets me irritated is when I turn on the television and I see some of these things that are not the church that I see biblically, and then you hear about other people that are just mocking them, as they should be, unfortunately, and then comparing people like us to those kinds of people. And it turns people off, and they say, oh, church, I don't want anything to do with it because I've seen what church is like. And that just grieves my heart, because I think to myself, no, they haven't seen what church is like. And so when we read in Acts chapter 15 today, this threat that comes in, I think it's important for us to understand that that threat is still going on in and among us today. That there are many, many, many wolves who are in sheep's clothing. And of course, we've been hearing about that. We've been hearing the warnings about that. Now, understand this, that at the heart of this threat, the source of this threat, since the beginning of time, is none other than Satan himself. Every pathetic second of his life is focused on seeking a way to destroy the church, to destroy the bride of Christ. For in doing so, he would hope that somehow he could defeat God. Now we're studying through the book of Acts specifically to understand the church in its purest biblical form. And in order to fully understand it, it's important to take a look at the very first use of the word church in the New Testament, that word church which was spoken by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So hold your place there in chapter 15 of Acts and head back to Matthew, the very first book in the New Testament, the first gospel, Matthew chapter 16, verse 13. We've looked at this a number of times. I never get tired of reading it because as a church purist, I guess I would call myself, I want to be a church purist. I want to understand what the Bible says about church. And the best way for me to understand it is how did the church begin and what was it that the church was established upon? And we're going to see here in Matthew chapter 16, beginning in verse 13, it is one of the most powerful and important interactions that Jesus ever had with one of the apostles. It was one which took place at Caesarea Philippi approximately 2 years into Jesus' preaching ministry. We talked about it briefly last week and how the meeting, this interaction took place in the midst of an area inundated with the worship of false gods. And in that interaction, here in Matthew 16, beginning in verse 13, we read of the very first of only three mentions. This is interesting. There's only three mentions of the word church here in the Gospels, and all three of them are found in the Gospel of Matthew. Now, the word church here, it comes from the Greek word ecclesia, which means called out. It is a reference to the called people. It's a reference to the people who are called out of darkness into God's marvelous light. And the reason it was used here, and this is so fascinating and so important to understand, the reason that it was used here for the first time was to differentiate it from the Jewish community, which comes from the Greek word synagogue, from which we get the word synagogue. This word ecclesia, it is used for the first time because Jesus intended that this church, that the called out ones, would be so unique, so different, that it would never be associated with any other kind of public gathering. And it's important to make that distinction because what do we see a lot happening today? We see a lot of things done in the name of church, and if it's just a bunch of people that sit around and pray, doesn't matter if they chant. Doesn't matter if they try to get in touch with 14 or 15 different higher powers. None of that matters. We just so loosely call it the church, and that is not the church. And I think it's important that we understand it. The word ecclesia, this Greek word, it denotes the New Testament community of the redeemed in its twofold aspect. First of all who were called by and to Jesus Christ in the fellowship of his salvation, the church worldwide at all times, and only secondarily to an individual church, designated as the church of God, the body of Christ, the church in Jesus Christ. It refers to exclusively the entire church, the church at large, of which we are a part of that, this body of believers. And secondly, it refers to the New Testament churches, also confined to certain places, to individual local churches. So we would have the body of believers, the body of Christ at large, of which we are a smaller part of that larger body. and then the place in which we meet. In here in Puyallup at South Hill Calvary Chapel would be another distinction of the church. Now, note this. Nowhere in Scripture where the word ecclesia is used, is it used of heathen religious assemblies. And that's really, really important for us to understand what church is all about. Nowhere will you see in Scripture that word ecclesia used as it relates to any other type of assembly than the assembly of those who had been called out of darkness, brought into the marvelous light of Christ through being born again, through believing in faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ to save man from their sin. Now, why is that an important distinction? Because in an effort to define and understand what church is supposed to be, we need to make sure that it is not all-inclusive of every church who in one obscure way or another names the name of Jesus Christ. For instance, as we talked about a few weeks ago, the Mormon church, it is not an ecclesia. It is a gathering of people, but it is not an ecclesia in the New Testament sense. It is not a New Testament church. It is a heathen church because it does not adhere to, it does not follow the biblical understanding of who Jesus is and God's plan for salvation. I had somebody just recently ask me, just this last week, they asked me, somebody I hadn't met with, well, in fact, it was a PJ DeTillo who was at our church for a number of years, and then they just recently moved, about a year ago, they moved to New Mexico. And he asked me at the end of our conversation with that intensity that only PJ can throw out at there, he says, I want you to tell me what's the Lord doing in your heart right now. And I put down my food or whatever, and I said, well, here's what he's speaking to my heart. Number one, that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming back soon. And number two, he's burdened my heart for the number of false conversions that there are out there. I'm heavy-hearted about that. And one of the reasons those false conversions are out there is because we've broadened this road and we're afraid to call a spade a spade. We're afraid to call things for what they are. And I don't do it maliciously. I don't do it arrogantly. I don't do it pridefully, nor do I see that Paul ever did that. But I see a need today for us to identify what it is that Jesus meant by the church. Because when a church doesn't adhere to the biblical definition of the church, then it is not ecclesia. It is not the called out ones. And yet over the centuries, people, and I want to emphasize people, have changed the biblical meaning of the word church, ecclesia, to called out ones to whatever particular set of beliefs a particular group of people had. And I refuse to be identified in a universal sense to people who do not believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the only way that we can attain an intimate relationship with a perfect God in heaven. Amen? I'm not going to go there. Lord, give us wisdom on how we can communicate that truth, but we must stand for that truth as we've seen Paul doing that, and he's preparing to do it all the more. It's imperative that in understanding what the church is supposed to be today, that we understand what Jesus intended it to be. Because he's the head of the church, amen? He's the one that's in charge of it all. It's not Pastor Ron's church, it's his church. He's the one, he's the groom, we're his bride. And so we want to hear what he had to say when he established it. And so I want to look once again at this all-important interaction that Jesus had with the future leaders of the church. Matthew chapter 16, verse 13, look what it says. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, Who do men say that I am, that I the Son of Man am? And so they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, and one of the prophets. And Jesus said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, and he said, you are the Christ. Of course, Christ is the Greek word for Messiah, referring to the one who would come and take away the sins of the world and save people from themselves. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Verse 17, Jesus answered and said to him, Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. In other words, Simon, this isn't something that you made up. This isn't something you came up by yourself. This wasn't something you decided to have a club about or a social gathering about. He says, this is not something you came up with by yourself, but my Father who is in heaven has revealed it to you. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock. Now, the Catholic Church has gotten off base here, and they believe, based on this right here, that Peter was the very first pope, that he was the rock of the church, that he was the first pope. There's no historical evidence whatsoever to that fact. They've taken that belief and they've run with it. But here's what he meant. And on this rock, that is on the statement of faith in who I am, that I am the Christ, that I am the Messiah, that I am the Son of the living God who came down from heaven to die for the sins of the world, on that statement of faith which you just made, I will build my church, my ecclesia. On the people that make that statement of faith, what are we? We're a bunch of people that made that statement of faith, called out of darkness, and now we're gathered here to understand, okay, how do we live that out in our lives from all different kinds of angles and all different perspectives. And he goes on to say, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom. Now again, this is one of the reasons they believe Peter was the first pope. He was the rock of the church, and he was given the keys of the kingdom. Well, what were the keys of the kingdom of heaven? Well, the keys to the kingdom of heaven, listen, are the preaching of the gospel. It is the preaching of the gospel and a person's acceptance of that gospel by faith that opens the door to heaven. That's the key to the kingdom of heaven, the preaching of the gospel. The good news of salvation, that a person is saved by faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ, which imputes righteousness to a person who by faith accepts this proof, this truth. And so Jesus goes on to say, therefore, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Now, just a side note about that particular verse. There's a lot of binding and loosing ministries out there. They're deliverance ministries where you're always looking to bind and loose these different demonic spirits. I'm going to bind and loose the spirit of wanting to eat too much chocolate. I'm going to bind and loose the spirit of bad thinking, of negative thoughts. I mean, all kinds of things. And this is one of the texts they use to support their teaching out of context. Because such a ministry, it's just not biblical. And that's a whole different teaching. It's just not a biblical ministry. And unfortunately, I've seen more harm than good that ever comes from that sort of a ministry. What did Jesus mean by binding and loosening? Listen, in the context, when the gospel is preached, it is either received or rejected, right? And if it is rejected, then a person is declared by that rejection to be continually bound by their sin on earth and therefore bound in heaven. In other words, they're not going to make it into heaven. However, if they receive it by faith, they are forever loosed from their sin. Therefore, they're loosed from the bondage of the world and they're able to go into heaven. And that's the context. You always want to look at the verse in the context of the setting. And that happens only through the proclamation of the gospel. It's not something Peter did. It's not something any of us does. It is simply a work of the Holy Spirit by what? By the proclamation of the gospel. Now, it's interesting to note that the only other two times that the word church is used in the gospels is also in Matthew, and it's in Matthew chapter 18, verse 17, and it's a reference to, again, ecclesia, to the called out ones, Christians, and how they're to deal with sin in the church. It is the chapter which speaks of church discipline, and is that bit of discipline that says, okay, there's somebody in the church They're acting up. They've fallen into sin. They're wanting everybody to embrace that sin. You go tell them. You talk to them. You tell them you're having a problem with them and that they need to repent. And if they don't listen, you get a couple more people to go with you and you tell them the same thing. And if they don't listen, then you bring it up to the church. And if they don't listen to that, then you cast them out. Look what it says, Matthew 18:17. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. Tell it to the gathering of called out ones, but if refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you as a heathen and a tax collector. Now, why does he say that? Is it because, well, because you got a special club and you got to kick them out of the club if they don't follow the rules? No, that's not what he's saying. Understand this. The Lord regards his bride, his church, as something so sacred, something so pure, something so set apart for him, that when sin enters into the camp, he wants it to be dealt with. And the sooner that you deal with it, by putting it out of the camp, if they refuse to repent, the sooner they're out in the camp, like the prodigal, eating pig slop and saying, boy, I think I want to go home, back to my church family, and they go. And when they come back, you say, praise the Lord, and you just welcome them with just open arms. And I think one of the great mistakes that the church is making today is they're not adhering to a strict biblical church discipline. I've never seen an extension of grace given to someone who does not have a repentant heart. I've never seen that lead them to repentance. What it does for them is it just causes them to just camp out and hang out in their sin. And who doesn't want to be able to just hang out in their sin and come to church and experience all the benefits of body life? Well, everybody naturally would want to do that. So that there in chapter 16 and here in chapter 18, those are the only three uses of the word church. And then the very first use then in the book of Acts is here in Then here in chapter 15, the reason this is so important is because we need to understand what this church, what this ecclesia, the called out ones, is supposed to be and in turn supposed to do. And we come to this chapter and we find this chapter placed neatly right in the middle of Paul's first and second missionary journey. Journeys in which Paul was doing what? He was establishing churches. So he was going out, he was establishing churches throughout the known world, and it is this in this chapter, right after he comes back, that we see the first and the greatest threat to the church early on in the history of the church. And we're going to learn that that same threat is still rampant among people who are seeking all sorts of ways to get into heaven. And again, if you can find a way to get into heaven without having to repent, every one of us is going to sign up for it. Naturally, we're going to sign up for that. And it doesn't work. And the Lord made it clear that it doesn't work that way. In fact, we're going to see that it continues to threaten the Christian church as well. So turn back to Acts chapter 15. Let's go ahead and stand together. And we're going to look at the first five verses. And then over the next couple of times together, we'll look in detail. There's so much to glean from these verses in chapter 15. Beginning in verse 1. And certain men came down from Judea and taught the brethren, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Therefore, when Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and dispute with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain others of them should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. And so being sent on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, describing the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy to all the brethren. And when they had come to Jerusalem, they were received by the church and the apostles and the elders, and they reported all things that God had done with them. But some of the sect of the Pharisees who believed rose up, saying, it is necessary to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. Father, we come before you. We ask that just for the next several minutes, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts about not only what the church is to be, but how we can guard ourselves from ever being what the church was not meant to be, Lord. We know that your church is to be representative of your heart to the world, that we're to be the fragrance of Christ, that we're to be the light of Christ, that we're to be the salt of the earth. And yet, Lord, we pray that today that you would set in our minds the importance of setting aside preconceived ideas and notions and even things, Lord, that have begun to cause us to question that what is at the very, very heart of the church, the body of believers, the ecclesia, the called out ones, O Lord. Put a hedge of protection around our hearts and our minds and our ears that we might hear clearly what the Holy Spirit has for us, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. What did we read in verse 18 of Matthew 16? The Lord said, I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock, that is on that statement of faith that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Now, why did Jesus say that? He said that because he knew that Satan would attempt in every way to prevail against the church. And even though Satan knows that ultimately he will not prevail, he also knows that any attempt to misrepresent the church, any attempt to defy the church, or defile the church, any attempt to get people to misrepresent God to the rest of the world will hurt the cause of Christ and will ultimately draw people away from the only hope of heaven, and that is being reconciled to God through faith in Jesus Christ. And so he'll do anything he can to complicate it. He'll do anything he can to twist it up, to try to make it something that the Lord never intended it to be. And what is so significant and so amazing to me, as I've shared before, is that God's using the Apostle Paul. God's using a Pharisee to bring this about, a Pharisee to establish his church, when at one time Paul, Saul of Tarsus was his Hebrew name, was an enemy of the church. He was public enemy number one to the church. And Paul later writes to the churches in Galatia, those churches that he had established in his first missionary journey, he writes to them and he says, look, I know you've heard of my former conduct in Judaism, how as a Pharisee, as a religious zealot for salvation, that it was salvation through keeping the letter of the law. I know you've heard that, and how I persecuted the church of God beyond measure, and I tried to destroy it. And Paul was burdened by the reality that that's what he had tried to do, and which made him all the more passionate to make sure that the cause of Christ was accurately represented to the people who so desperately needed to hear it. And that's why, right at this moment, right as what's happening, this long period of time that he stays with them, he is writing out this epistle, this letter to the churches of Galatia. And he writes to those churches with these things in mind. He writes in Galatians 1:6, I marvel that you're turning away so soonly from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel. You see, this other way, this perverted gospel, this distorted gospel, had begun to creep into these churches that he just planted. And you can just sense with a broken heart, he's writing this letter, and he's saying, I marvel that so soon you're turning away to a different gospel, which isn't another. He says, there's some who want to trouble you. They want to pervert. They want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel of heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. Now, I find it interesting that the Bible tells us that that Satan is able to disguise himself as an angel of light. And in light of that, he says, but even if we or an angel from heaven, in other guys, don't be duped by somebody that comes in. Satan's able to disguise himself as an angel of light. If we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we've said before, now I say again, if anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. Literally, let him be damned to hell. And so Paul and Barnabas, along with the others, they're coming off this amazing missionary journey. where God had done these incredible things to establish the church, his ecclesia, these called out ones. And Paul would begin in the Jewish gatherings, the synagogue, and some of the Jews would believe, and then even more so, Gentiles would begin to believe, those Gentiles who had converted to Judaism, and now they're Christians, and in time, regular Gentiles would begin to come to faith. And as we saw in chapter 13 and 14, the Gentiles were so excited with the realization that they too could be saved. They were overjoyed with the understanding of God's grace. Jews were getting saved, overjoyed with the understanding of God's grace. Salvation through nothing they had done, nothing they could ever do, but rather the undeserved merit of what Jesus had already done on the cross. There's nothing we can do to save. This is so important, and we must never lose sight of this truth about the church today. It's the same truth yesterday, today, and forever, because it is the truth of Jesus Christ dying on the cross. If we forget that, then we run the risk of misleading people. Ultimately, this is the message we must convey to those whom we're preaching to. So amazing was this message, if you remember, in Acts 13. So liberating was this message that the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. And in fact, on that very next Sabbath, it says that the whole city, almost the whole city, came together to hear the word of God, the good news of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. And so we mustn't forget, as we look at these five verses, we mustn't forget, as we get the sense of what we're looking at for the next couple of weeks, Paul's passion and his commitment to the gospel was so strong that he was willing literally to be stoned to death. And when the Lord raised Paul up from the dead, what did he do? He went right back into the city and he kept on preaching. He understood the seriousness of this. And furthermore, after preaching and establishing churches in other cities, then he goes back to Lystra where he was stoned to death. Why? It says to strengthen the souls of the disciples. Because when you start adding something other than faith in Jesus Christ, you're messing with a person's soul. You're messing. He knew that they were messing with the souls of the disciples. So he goes back in to strengthen them and to exhort them to continue in the faith. And so here he is right now back in Antioch. He's been spending a long time with them, telling them all the things that God had done with them, how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews, how he stayed with them for a long time. And he's writing this letter to the churches of Galatia. And I believe he's just loving church. I believe he's just loving the gathering together of these called out ones. And it says, verse 1, certain men came down from Judea and taught the brethren. Now, it's important to keep these in mind, this in mind. These are not the men that were trying to kill. These are not the men that stoned them. These are not the men that kept following them all around trying to get them arrested. These were men who were from Judea, and they were believers. They had accepted Christ. They had been saved, but they got unsettled in their salvation. They started thinking, maybe it isn't enough. See, that's the enemy. The enemy comes in. One of the things that he'll always come in, he'll get you to try to question your salvation, especially a new believer. Oh, you're not really saved. You said a bad word the other day, man. Don't you know what the Bible, don't you know what Jesus says? Therefore, if you shall be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. That wasn't very perfect, was it? And pretty soon you start questioning your own salvation. And these men, they were coming from Judea. We don't know what prompted them, but what they say is, unless you're circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. Now, Jesus had told the apostles in John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He said nothing about the law. Peter had preached to the Sanhedrin, the highest Jewish ruling council of Sadducees and Pharisees. And he says in Acts 4:10, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. This is the stone which was rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven by which man can be saved. No mention of the Mosaic law. No mention of having to do anything else. No mention of having to be circumcised. And then in chapter 13, Paul, the Pharisee who was born again. He had been faithfully preaching. Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man Jesus is preached to you the forgiveness of sins, and by him everyone who believes is justified from all things from which he could not be justified by the law of Moses. In other words, there's no other way to salvation. No mention of the law. In fact, a rejection of the law, saying that you can't be justified by the law of Moses. Listen carefully. The point is that when we think for one second that there is something we can do to get to heaven on our own, something that we can do to be saved, we are suggesting that we can get to heaven by another name. And whose name is that? By our own name. We're suggesting that we can get to heaven by our own name. And we know scripturally that that is an impossibility. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. The moment, the instant we suggest that there is something else we need to do of our own merit to be saved, it is no longer salvation by grace, but is salvation by works. And that's what was going on here. And that is what differentiates Christianity from all other false religions. Salvation, getting right with God, is based on what you have to do rather than what Jesus Christ has already done. And I love that the Lord set it up that way. It is the best apologetics to somebody who is suggesting that they have the way. All you have to do is ask any other false religion, how is it that you get to heaven? And they're going to explain at some level the things that they have to do to make sure you get to heaven. And then if they say to you, well, how do you get to heaven? Say, I place my trust and faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ that washed my sins as white as snow, made me pure, I stand righteous before a holy God. When I die, bam, I'm in the presence of the living God. And they're going to go, well, how's that quite work? And then they're going to resort to, and you just stand firm on that. Don't argue. Just say, you know what? All I know is I stand, I'm in love with my God. I'm at peace with my God because Jesus was the propitiation for my sins. And I love that how Christianity is differentiated from all these other false religions based on what Jesus accomplished. What were these men doing? Remember Acts 14:2, it says, but the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their mind against the brethren. Now these are believing Jews, but they're adding something to faith in Christ which is poisoning the minds of these new believers. Therefore, look at verse 2, when Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and dispute with them. This was no small deal. This was no small dispute. This was no small discussion or meetings about how to take an offering, about how many songs to do before the message. Should we stand? Should we sit? Should we have healthy snacks or unhealthy snacks at the hospitality table? Should we have coffee or decaf, or should we provide a variety of teas? These were some serious issues. He says, no, this was no small dissension. It was no small dispute because they were suggesting that there was another way to be saved than through faith in the Lordship of Jesus Christ. It's huge. It's a big deal. It's the most important thing that had happened at this point. And so they determined, and also notice how quickly it happened. How quickly it happened in the church. It's so important to understand that, how quickly it can happen in any church. That's why you start getting away from the Word of God, and next thing you know, you're starting to believe in things you ought not be believing in. So when Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain others of them should go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. Now, Jerusalem from Antioch in Syria, Jerusalem was 300 miles away. And I believe they would generally travel by foot, which was about 10 or 12, maybe 15 miles a day. So at the very best, if they were cooking, they were going to make it in 20 days. And so what do? Well, it says that as they went along the way, they began to just describe the conversion of the brethren. Do you understand why this was the most important meeting in church history? Because I want you to consider what was going on in these people's hearts, what was going on, the emotions of these people. Finally, they're set free from the bondage of the law finally they're walking in the joy and the freedom and the grace. They're just loving the Lord Jesus. They're loving being his called out ones. They're loving being his bride. And all of a sudden somebody comes in and says, you know what, it's not quite enough. There's something more you need to do. And so people are greatly concerned. They're greatly confused. I don't think there's anything worse you can do to someone, especially a new believer, is to put cause to question them, to question their salvation. Your position is secure. Jesus made it clear that if anyone is in Christ, they're that new creation. He says, you're my child, you're my sheep, and no one can snatch you out of my Father's hand. And somebody comes in and they try to stir you up and they try to cause confusion, and that's what was happening. And Paul, his passion is he was once a Pharisee. He was once in bondage to those false teachings. And he was part of trying to destroy the church, which would have made him all the more determined to give his life for anything that would hinder people coming to faith or causing people to question God's heart for man in any way. Paul understood how very threatening this message was to the church, to being called out from bondage, the bondage of legalism, into the great and glorious place of God's grace, his unmerited favor and love upon a sinful man. And so verse 3 says, being sent on their way by the church, by the brethren, by the called out ones. Yeah, go, find out. And you think that, I bet that was a long, probably 60 days, as they're waiting for news. Again, they couldn't, we just got a text from Paul, looks like all's good. We don't need to do the circumcision thing. Didn't happen that way. They were waiting. Has anybody caught wind? Has anybody heard? They were sent by the way. They passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, describing the conversion of the Gentiles. And they caused great joy to all the brethren, confirmations of all that God had been doing. Verse 4, and when they'd come to Jerusalem, they were received by the church, the apostles, and the elders. And they reported all things that God had done with them. Now note these three groups of people, which we're going to be looking at in more detail next week. The church, the apostles, and the elders. It says, but some of the sect of the Pharisees who believed, circle those two words, who believed. These were believers. They rose up saying, it is necessary to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. So there was so much at stake. There was so much at stake. The very possibility that they could lose their salvation, what was being threatened. I mean, imagine if I stood up here one day to you and I said, brothers and sisters, in my studies this week, I've discovered some startling news. That is, the sufficiency of Christ isn't complete. Now, if that happened, you'd take me out and beat me up really bad. And a guy like Brian would probably lead the charge. He'd be the first one, and he'd come up and grab me and drag me out. Why? Because you're well-fed, because we're all in agreement. But imagine if we were a church full of new believers, and maybe I didn't take you through the Word of God week after week after week. Imagine if I said, I've discovered some new revelation, and there's some things. Imagine how your hearts would begin to sink. And because you would know, you know, what does this mean? Am I in? Am I out? There would be just this threat of this wonderful community of believers that we have together. And that's why it's so important that we understand the seriousness of this issue. Because there are going to be all kinds of people who come. They're going to get saved, as some of you new believers. I had somebody come who's just new to the church, and after first service, they come to me and she said, thank you. Thank you for reminding me what church is supposed to be. I was saved when I was a little girl, and I had gone down a bad path and this and that, and thank you for just reminding me that it is all about Jesus Christ paying the penalty for my sins on the cross. Thank you for reminding me what church is supposed to be. We're the called out ones. We're the ecclesia. This morning, I got a text message at 2:40 in the morning. And sometimes I get my text messages and it can be, a notice that somebody posted on Facebook at 2:40 in the morning that my dog got cleaned or something. I don't know what it might be. But But so I was asleep. I heard the dings go off, and then I went back to sleep. 3:30, I checked it at 3:30, and it was somebody in our church whose little girl they had to take into the emergency room. And they had to put her in a hospital at Good Sam, or in an ambulance, and take her to Mary Bridge, which, by the way, she's stabilized, and they think they're going to be able to get it taken care of. But I get it at 3:30, and I read it at 3:30, and I begin to pray, and I forward it to Pastor Allen, our children's ministry pastor. About 4:30, I call the individual. They were in the hospital, and I prayed with them. I encouraged him, just called on the sovereignty of God to minister in the situation. Then when I saw Pastor Allen, probably around 6:45, 6:30, I asked him if he got the forwarded message, text message, and he said yes, he had, and he had already talked to the individual around 6 o'clock. And then I asked him, I said, hey, how was your day yesterday? And he said, oh, I had a great day yesterday. He said, I had the kids, because Melissa was at the women's ministry meeting, and then afterwards we went to a couple of the children in the church whose birthdays are at the same time, and we went to their birthday party. And then he said, then afterwards I went to somebody's house who needs some help mowing their lawn, and so I mow their lawn every week for them. Now I was thinking about what I did last night, and I studied all day and just got ready for service, and then my wife Jenny and I, we were going to go to Veritas. I usually teach at Veritas, and it was one of those weeks where there's just no way I was going to get it done. And Jason Strayer graciously said he would teach, and I was just so looking forward to going to, my wife and I, we went to dinner, and then we were going to go sit in church. We don't get to sit in church and just get fed and worship and act like regular church people. We don't get to do that often, and so I was really looking forward to doing that, and there was a couple of kids that were being real bratty in the children's ministry. Come find out, it was my grandchildren, and so no, actually, they weren't being bratty, but they were having a tough down time. They were melting down, and it was pretty hard to pass up the opportunity when they were just grabbing, and they're, you know, you're hugging and loving on them. And I did the announcements, so I went out and did the announcements, and then I had to lay my life down, and I had to go back in there. And I'll tell you, I've not spent a lot of time in children's ministry, and I have to admit, I thought that. 2-year-olds were a little easier than that. I thought their attention span was a little longer than 35 seconds. I really did. I was thankful for the fruit roll-ups that we had. I was thankful for the Play-Doh, the stickers, sticker books of Jesus that we made, flannel board. I told the story on the flannel board of Jesus' birth. I took a little license and added a few little things in there just in the spur of the moment under the pressure that I was under, and then I was thankful that I could play the guitar, and I sang a bunch of songs, and we ended the night with everybody just dancing around and having a grand old time. And my point is this: does it really get any better than that? I don't think so. Does it really get any better than what I get to do every day of my life as a part of this body of called out ones? I don't think so. Is there anything better that I get to do than stand before you right now and delve into the scriptures and see what church is supposed to be? I don't think so. Is there anything better to do this afternoon than to go and hang out with a bunch of people and throw a softball around and eat some food and fellowship with one another and laugh with one another and pray with one another and just consider what it means to be His church, to be His ecclesia, His called out ones? And I would suggest to you, no, there isn't anything better. This is church. This is what it means to be the bride of Christ. The ones who have been redeemed through the precious blood of the Lamb, we're the bride of Christ. We're a community of followers of Jesus Christ who love Him above all else with all of our hearts, with all of our minds, with all of our souls, with all of our strength. And we are motivated by that love for Him in everything we do. We're motivated by His unending love for us. That's what motivates us. When that's threatened in any way whatsoever, we must take a stand for that threat, against that threat. Amen? We have to take a stand against it. And we need God's wisdom. We need His heart. Because there are a lot of people that are taking a stand, and they're not taking a stand against threats against the church. They're taking stand against threats against their principles. But when the very heart of a person's salvation. When the very methodology of the proclamation of the gospel is hindered in any way under the guise of entertainment or anything else, and there's the risk, the slightest risk, that somebody could leave here thinking that they have something that they don't, then we have to take a stand against that. We have to be willing to rally together and to love and to care for one another and to support one another and to be in fellowship with one another. And I've got to tell you, I love the church. I love the body. It's a passion of mine. Why? Because we're married to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who sit at the right hand of the throne of God, and we're awaiting his soon return to come and to take his bride to be with him. That's why we're passionate. Am I passionate about an institution? No. I'm passionate about a living group of people called out to be lovers of God. And that's why, listen, when we get upset with each other, when we get angry with one another, we don't have the option of just bailing. We don't have the option of just leaving because you get mad at somebody, because we don't like the way something's done. Yes, there, you know, there's the Church Universal is big. This isn't the only deal. But none of us, listen, none of us have the privilege, or none of us should ever think we have the opportunity to just blow out of here and move on to the next place like, you know, it's just a revolving door. No, we got to make sure that we do it in love, because we're bound together by the blood of Christ. Amen? We're bound together. And so I don't expect that everybody would stay here till I hope everybody would stay till the Lord comes back, or till we die, because I love what we have together. But at the very least, if the Lord calls any of us to leave, we're to make sure that we leave in a good way, that we're loving and that we're supporting one another. It was so cool. P.J. DeTillo, who's been gone a year, and he used to be an elder at our church before he left, and you know, he and I butted heads on more than one occasion, but it was so rich, it was so good to see him and to just give him a big old hug and just get caught up and just talk about the things of the Lord. And it's so important that we understand our responsibility to one another to make sure that we're always living in peaceful harmony in the Lord. And sometimes that means we have to die to ourselves, and we have to humble ourselves and make right with one another. Amen? There's some of you, I mentioned this at first service, there may be some of you that get mad at some of the eldership. I know you'd never get mad at me, but you never know, that could happen. Some of you may be mad at me right now for something, and I don't even know what you're mad at me about. How can I know unless you come and tell me, so that I can either, so I can apologize. Maybe it's I've offended you in some way, or maybe you've offended somebody else in some way, and you're just not aware of that. Well, we're obligated to one another to make one another aware of that, so that we can make right. And that's how we maintain this beautiful, wonderful relationship with one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. And I love that. I love that. And I'm committing my life to just ensuring that, Lord, I want to be a part of a church that is what your word declares it to be. Those who respond, we say that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen? Let's stand together and pray. Oh, I want to sing that song again, God in my breathing, God in my waking, God in my sleeping. Because brothers and sisters, that is what is going to, if we would just sing that every morning when we wake up, that is what's going to hold us together as the body of Christ. Because when he is the center of everything we do, we are compelled to live in a manner that is going to keep us in harmony with one another, and is certainly it is going to cause us to be the fragrance of Christ to a fallen world. So let's just close as we sing that together. And as we do, at any time, we always have people up here to pray with you. And you know, we can kind of laugh and joke a little bit, but seriously, there may be some of you that are mad at me for some reason, or you're harboring ill feelings towards somebody else, or maybe you're thinking, oh, here we go, we're going to have a special church service. I wonder what that's going to be all about. And the enemy's just got you in there. Just, you got an opportunity to just confess that. I'll never be mad at you when you come to me and just say, you know, you offended me, or you hurt me, or I'm fearful of this or fearful of that. And I won't even be mad at you if you don't come to me, but I'll be hurt that you didn't, because we don't have an opportunity to make sure that relationship remains what God intends it to be. So if there's anything on your heart whatsoever, I want to encourage you, just before we conclude our service, to just come forward to pray. Let's sing and just worship the Lord together.
God in my heaven, God in my breathing, God in
our prayer, that you would be our everything this week as we go out, as we go forth. Lord, if there's anything that goes on in the course of the week that just causes us to contradict that which we've expressed from our heart in song, that you would just stir us to repentance and to a full surrender in you, Lord. Thank you so much, Lord, for this afternoon. We look forward to later this evening and just a sweet, sweet time of fellowship as we break bread together and recreate together and just enjoy one another's company. Help us to appreciate the church, the body of Christ, like never before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. If any of you need prayer, feel free to come forward and we'd be happy to pray with you.